Hello and welcome to Holy Impact Ministries Bible Study Night. I'm Pastor Scott Villain with HolyImpactMinistries.com. God bless you and thank you for sharing your time with us here this Wednesday night at 8 o'clock. We are studying the 8th chapter of the book of Romans. Now, if you haven't seen the previous chapters of Romans that we have studied, we urge you to please take a look at them. We have gone through a lot of information concerning the Apostle Paul and the context, the proper context that needs to be known before we even dive into the writings of the Apostle Paul to know and understand what he was talking about. Once again, we know from the writings of 2 Peter 3:16, he gives us a warning about the writings of Paul. In fact, let's go take a look at that very quickly. Let me get over to, 2 Peter 3:16 very quickly, and we'll take a look at it. Again, this is just for our new viewers who have not watched this from the beginning. This is what Peter tells us about the writings of Paul. Again, this is a warning from Peter that the writings of Paul are hard to understand. He says, there are some things in them, starting with 2 Peter 3:16, there are some things in them that are hard to understand, which the ignorant and the unstable twist to their own destruction as they do the other scriptures. And again, he's talking here about the writings of the Apostle Paul. He says, you therefore, beloved, knowing this beforehand, take care that you are not carried away with the error of lawless people and lose your own stability. So we can know and we can understand that there is a warning about the writings of Paul. And what Peter's basically saying is, you know, you've got to know and understand who Paul was talking to, who his audience was, what were the challenges that Paul was up against in order to know and understand what he was saying about the law of God. And Paul was accused of preaching against the laws of God and accused of preaching against circumcision. And we know very clearly from James that Paul was not preaching against circumcision, nor was he preaching against the laws of God. And again, all we have to do is take a look at Romans 3:31, and Paul asks the question. He says, do we nullify the law by our faith? And he answers the question. He says, by no means, on the contrary. He says, we uphold the law. Romans 3:31, look it up for yourself very clearly. It is a statement by the Apostle Paul. In fact, let's go over to Romans 3:31. I just want to show this to you rather than just telling you that it is there. I'd rather show it to you. Here it is right here at the bottom of the screen. We'll highlight it in blue so that you can see it. Romans 3:31. Paul asks the question, do we overthrow the law by this faith? He says, by no means. On the contrary, we uphold the law. Now, this is the same Apostle Paul that many of today's modern-day Pharisees are trying to preach and teach and say has nailed all of God's laws or a portion of God's laws to the cross. My friends, I want to just say this to you very quickly. You know, the next time you hear a pastor say this to you, ask him exactly, specifically, where is the scripture that says that part or some of God's laws were nailed to the cross and part or some of God's laws are not? Where exactly in the Word of God does it say that? Because it's not in there and you can't find it. And the reason you can't find it is because it's not in there. So we need to know and we need to understand these things, and we need to call these men of God that are teaching and preaching behind our pulpits today, we need to question these things. Where is it that God's laws are all nailed to the cross? He doesn't say that, and neither does the Apostle Paul, if we know who he was speaking to and exactly what he was talking about and which law was he talking about. So as we move through the 8th chapter of the book of Romans, again, there's a lot of things we need to know and understand. And you'll not know these things if you don't start from the beginning of this Bible study. And this is just a small tidbits of things that maybe you did not know and have not heard. If you have not heard them and you are not grounded in this understanding, please begin at the beginning. So, with that being said, let's go ahead and take a look at Romans chapter 8. We're going to go ahead and just dive right in. We have a lot to get through here. And we're going to go ahead and start. Romans 8:1, he says, now this is the Apostle Paul, and this is extremely interesting when we get from, we're just going to go from 8:1 to 8:7. And we're just going to read this section right here. He says this. He says, "There is therefore no condemnation." Let me get that color off of there. "There is therefore no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus." Now, what does this mean to be in Christ Jesus? He'll explain that as we go. He says, "For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death." Now, this is what Paul continuously speaks about in the book of Romans, is the law of sin and death. Paul does not say that the law is a curse or that the law is bondage when he says that if you are under the law, you are under the curse. Well, you are under the curse. What is the curse of the law? Well, we know that the biblical definition of sin is the transgression of the law. That's biblical definition of sin. Okay? Now, what is the wages of sin? The wages of sin is death. What did our Messiah come to do away with? He did not come to do away with the law. We know that because if we look at Matthew 5:17, what does he say? Let's take a look at Matthew 5:17. He says, this is our Messiah speaking, red letter words. He says, "Do not think that I've come to abolish the law or the prophets. I've not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them." Now, he uses the word abolish and fulfill in the same sentence. So we can know that the word fulfill does not mean abolish, okay? Because if it did, he wouldn't use them both in the same sentence. He says, "I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them." So he came not to do one thing, but to do another thing, okay? He did not come to abolish them or erase them or nail them to a cross. He said, "I came to fulfill them. I came to do them." He says, "For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not an iota, not a dot will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever relaxes one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." So we can know and understand that our Messiah did not come to abolish the laws. He says so right here. In fact, he says, until heaven and earth pass away, he says, not an iota, not a dot, not the crossing of a T, not the dotting of an I will pass from the law until all is accomplished, until heaven and earth pass away. And we know through, if we read the book of Revelations, that the heaven and earth has not passed away as of yet, and all has not been accomplished as of yet. So we can know and understand these things if we will just know and understand our Bible. And if we read the Bible, it's very easy to know and understand what he's talking about here. So he says, "For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from," what does he say here? Does he say from the law of God? So if we cover this up, and this is what many of today's modern day pastors, priests, bishops, and popes will say, they will cut this off right here. So let's go here and let's just color this out, because that's what they do. And this is what they want to say. They're trying to say, "For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law." But that's not what it says. That is not what it says, and we know that. It says, "For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death," the penalty of the law, not the laws of God. And many of these pastors, priests, bishops, and popes today, modern day Pharisees and scribes, will tell you that this, the law of sin and death, is not what Paul was talking about. He was talking about the law, and that these words at the end of this sentence do not exist. But we can know and we can understand what the law of sin and death is. It was the penalty of the law. That was the curse of the law, okay, was death. If you sinned, you transgressed the law. That is what the biblical definition of sin is. And then what was the wages of that sin? Death. That's what it was. So you had to then sacrifice an animal to account for, try to cover that sin up. Okay? And so that's what our Messiah, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, came to do. And Paul says so right here in 8:2, we find it very clearly. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death, not from the laws of God. I want us to see that, and I want us to know that. Okay, let's continue. He says, for God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do, by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh. And for sin, he condemned sin in the flesh, in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. So what is he saying here? Now, many pastors, priests, bishops, and popes will tell you that this verse right here says that Yeshua died so that the righteous requirement of the law can be fulfilled in us. And that's all there is to it. Because he died, that's all that has to happen. But that's not what it says here, is it? That's not what it says here. It says, in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who do what? Who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. You see, my friends, if you have Christ, if you have put on the Messiah, as Paul is speaking about here, you will be walking not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. God's laws, the new covenant found in Jeremiah 31:31, and you can read it for yourself, is all about Yahweh God the Father writing his laws in our hearts and in our minds, not nailing them to a cross. That's not found anywhere in the Bible, anywhere. And you can't find it, and it's not in there. And the reason you can't find it is because it's not in there. Okay, Paul says very clearly here, he says, that our Messiah died in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Now listen to this, because we're going to prove this out as he goes along. He says, for those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, the things of this world. But those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. For to set the mind on the flesh is death. If you're thinking about the flesh and what the flesh wants, it's going to lead you to death, is what he's saying here. But to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. Now, what's the difference between setting your mind on the flesh or on the Spirit? Well, he says, we'll continue on, and he'll explain that. He says, for the mind that is set on the flesh, okay, is hostile to God. Okay, if your mind is on the flesh and what your body wants to do and what this world, assimilating yourself into the world, okay, which is what the flesh does, then you are hostile to God. For it does not submit to God's law. Do we hear what Paul is saying here right now? He says, indeed, it cannot. So let's read that again, Romans 8:7, and let's cement that in our minds, so that we may know that we are on the right track and understanding this properly. He says, for to set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God, for it does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. Those who are in the flesh cannot please God. Why? Because they don't submit to God's law. How many times have we heard, oh, all God's laws are nailed to the cross. Jesus nailed those to the cross. I'm once saved, always saved. Doesn't matter what I do, because Jesus nailed all my sins to the cross. Really? That's not what the Apostle Paul is teaching here at all, is it? And what does he say in Romans 3:31? We just read that. He says, do we nullify the law by our faith? Absolutely not. On the contrary, he says, we uphold the law. And what does he say here? He says, if you're setting your mind on the flesh, okay, instead of the Spirit, he says, that leads to death. You're not going to make it. He says, because the fleshly mind cannot submit to the laws of God. It doesn't want to submit to the laws of God. Okay? It doesn't want to keep the Sabbath. Doesn't want to keep the Passover. Doesn't want to keep his feast days, his appointments, his Moedim. They want to keep the world's Christmas and Easter and Lent and Valentine's Day and Halloween and all of this trash and garbage that men have heaped upon God's laws, his commandments, his precepts, his appointments. That's what the flesh wants to do, you see. Flying reindeer, fat men that come out of the fire to give your children all the gifts of their, all the things that their hearts desire, to be written in his good book, to deal with the divination of flying reindeer and magical elves and Easter bunnies that lay colored eggs and all of this nonsense that we have heaped on top of God's law to cover up God's appointments, to cover up God's laws, to cover up God's feast days, to cover up God's seventh day Sabbath that he anointed and made holy. That one day of the week is the seventh day, not the first, but the seventh. So this is exactly what Paul's talking about. He says, if your mind is on the flesh and you're going with you're just rolling with the world and you're just assimilating yourself into today's modern day version of Christianity without reading the Bible, without having the Holy Spirit, without learning from the Messiah, who is our teacher, our only teacher. There is only one mediator between us and God, and it is the Messiah, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ. This is exactly what Paul's talking about. He says, if your mind is on the flesh and your mind is on this world and you're listening to all these guys that are coming out of these modern day seminary schools who are owned and operated by any one of 5,000 different denominational charters of men, they are anointed by men, not anointed by God, just like the Pharisees of his time. Okay, they were anointed by men. They were not anointed by God. They were teaching the things of men. They were writing their own laws on top of God's laws. Read the 23rd chapter of Matthew and know what Yeshua was teaching about the pastors, priests, bishops, and popish leaders of his time. He called them the scribes and the Pharisees. That's what they were called. Today they're called pastors, priests, bishops, and popes. No difference. Same men. Same men. Same problems, same mistakes. They are bumbling and stumbling over top of the same mistakes that the Pharisees in his time were stumbling over. So this is what Paul was saying. He's saying, for the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God, for it does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. Those who are of the flesh cannot please God. You, however, are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If, in fact, the Spirit of God dwells in you. Okay, so what does all this mean? What is Paul saying here? He's really summing up the whole book of Romans in this chapter, chapter 8. Now, we can know and we can understand, what does it say very clearly? He who says he knows him and does not keep his commandments is what? Is a liar, and the truth is not in him. Okay, you can find that in 1 John 2:4. What about the biblical definition of the love of God? For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. Again, 1 John 5:3. We can look that up and know that and understand that. Everyone who makes a practice of sinning also practices lawlessness. Sinning is lawlessness. We can find that in 1 John 3:4. It tells us very clearly in Hebrews 10:26. In fact, let's go look at Hebrews 10:26. What does it say? Hebrews 10:26. Here it is. For if we go on sinning deliberately after receiving the knowledge of the truth, there no longer remains a sacrifice for sins, but a fearful expectation of judgment and a fury of fire that will consume the adversaries. Now listen to this. Now, this is for all of those of you out there who still believe in the once saved, always saved baloney. Listen to what it says. He said, if we go on sinning deliberately after the knowledge of the truth, knowing what the Messiah did, knowing that he died for our sins, knowing the price that he paid, that he was a propitiation for our sins, after knowing this, after knowing all of these things, and still continuing like a dog to our vomit to return to our sin, if we do that, He says there no longer remains a sacrifice for sins, but a fearful expectation of judgment and a fury of fire that will consume the adversaries. Anyone who has set aside the law of Moses dies without mercy on the evidence of two or three witnesses. He says, listen to this now. How much worse punishment do you think will be deserved by the one who has trampled underfoot the Son of God and has profaned the blood of the covenant by which he was sanctified and has outraged the Spirit of grace? How much worse punishment do you think will be deserved by those of us who have denied his Son? And that's exactly what Paul is saying here in Hebrews 10 and 26. We need to remember these things. And again, it just all comes down to knowing the Bible and what the Bible says. Okay, so we know very clearly that if we're walking in the flesh, according to the Apostle Paul, we are not going to make it. We are not going to make it into the coming kingdom. He says very clearly, because we are hostile to God. He said, because the carnal mind, the fleshly mind, cannot submit to God's law. Only those who have the Spirit of Yahweh, the Holy Spirit that was promised to us and was given to us at Pentecost, that Holy Spirit is needed. Because at that point in time, when we have faith, when we know and understand what our Messiah did, and we see this, the cost of sin, and we see what had to be done because of sin, we don't want to have anything more to do with sin after seeing that. And the laws of God are there to protect us, as they always have been, to protect us from sin. And we now have those laws written in our hearts. They mean something to us. We obey the laws of God not to be saved, not to earn our way into heaven, but because we love God, because we are saved. And we say this over and over and over again to help people know and understand. We don't obey the laws of God to be saved. We obey the laws of God because we are saved. And that's exactly what Paul is saying here. He says, to those who are in the flesh cannot please God. Okay, so those who are in the flesh cannot please God. You, however, are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if in fact the Spirit of God dwells in you. Now, once again, what did we just say in 1 John 2:4? What does it say? It says, he who says he knows him and does not keep his commandments is what? Is a liar, and the truth is not in him. If he's not keeping the commandments of God, then he is a liar, and the truth is not in him. First verse of Matthew 23, what does our Messiah say? He says, do what the scribes and the Pharisees tell you to do. In other words, do the Torah, do the laws of God, keep my commandments, keep my precepts, keep my appointments. He says, but don't do what they do, because they don't practice what they preach. And you can find that in the first chapter of Matthew 23. So a direct commandment coming from our Messiah, he says, do what the scribes and the Pharisees tell you to do. They sit in Moses' seat, also known as the Bema seat. Okay, so we know that he wants us to obey and do and keep the law. He tells us that's a direct commandment. They didn't have the New Testament at that time. The only thing that the scribes and the Pharisees could possibly be teaching would be the Torah, the instruction manual, the laws of God that are to be written in our hearts. If we believe and have faith and know what our Messiah did, there's no possible way that his laws could not be written in your heart and not nailed to some cross somewhere. Okay, so let's continue on. Let's see here. So he says, anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. Now, we looked at that word righteousness again. What is the biblical definition of righteousness? Obedience to the law. That is what righteousness is, to the laws, commandments, and the precepts of God. Okay? So let's read that again. But if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, when you are baptized in the water, you go down under the water, signifying being in the grave. You come back up a new person, okay? So this is what he's talking about through baptism. If Christ is in you, although the body is dead because you've been baptized, and it just as it was commanded, what does our Messiah tell us? You must be baptized by both the water and the Spirit, or you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven, quote unquote, from our Messiah. So he says, but if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. That means walking in the ways of God. That is the biblical definition of righteousness. Okay? So he says, if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. So then, brothers, we are debtors not to the flesh to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. Again, he's making a sharp contrast between those living in the flesh and in the world and assimilating yourselves to the things of the world and those of us who live in the Spirit. How does God want to be worshipped? He wants to be worshipped in spirit and in truth. In spirit and in truth. Is Jesus' birthday December 25th? No, it is not. Is that worshiping him in the spirit and in the truth? It is not. So these are the kinds of things we need to know and understand. If it's not, if you're not worshiping him in spirit and in truth, then you are not worshiping Yahweh God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and his son, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, our Messiah. You are worshiping another God. And that would be whoever made up this whole December 25th hooyah. It is not by spirit and truth that you are worshiping him, because it's not truth. You can't worship him in spirit and truth if you don't have the truth. And if it's a lie, a lie is a lie is a lie. You can't get away from it. And not to mention the fact that we know that every major sun god, from Tammuz to Mithra to Baal to Horus to Osiris, all of their birthdays, even though they lived at different times throughout history, all of their birthdays are December 25th. Our Messiah has nothing to do with December 25th, and we know that. And this is just a small example that I'm giving you. There are many things that today's modern day version of Christianity teaches, and we must come back to the original Hebraic understanding of God's word if we are going to make it through these times, these end times that we are now living in. We need to cast off and throw out the trash and the garbage and take it to the curb. And we need to worship our Messiah in spirit and in truth. And if it's not spirit and it's not truth, then we need to get rid of it. We need to clean our houses and go back to what Paul was talking about. Okay, so he says, if you're living according to the flesh, you'll die. But if you're living in the spirit and you put to death the deeds of the body, he says, then you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, like a dog returning to its vomit. He says, but you have received the spirit of adoption as sons, whom we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and followers and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with him. Excuse me. I don't know where that came from. Small tornado there. Okay, let's read that again, without the sneeze this time. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with him in order that we may also be glorified with him. Now, I want to go to very quickly, because what he is speaking about here, and I just want to reiterate this. Romans 8:11. I'm just going to bookmark this so we can get right back to it quickly. But I want to take us over to the book of Galatians. Let's take a quick look over at the book of Galatians, and we're going to go to 3:27. What does it say here? I want us to read this. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. Now listen to this. He says, there is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is no male. There is no female. For you are all one in Christ. Do we understand that? There's not even male and female as far as he's concerned. We are all one in Christ. And when we get to the 11th chapter of Romans, he will reiterate that and explain that even in a deeper way concerning the olive tree and being grafted into the olive tree. So he says here very clearly, Galatians 3:29, and if you are Christ's, and I'm going to highlight this because I want you to see this, and I don't want to leave any wiggle room here. Galatians 3:29, and if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring. If you are Abraham's offspring, then you are an Israelite. No other people in the Word of God anywhere are God's chosen people. No one is God's chosen people other than the Israelites. And if we are Christ's, we are offspring, the offspring of Abraham, and heirs according to the promise. So what's he talking about, us being heirs? This is exactly what he's talking about. If we're in Christ, then we are the offspring of Abraham, who is our true church father. Not these first, second, third, fourth, and fifth church fathers. This is our church father. If you want to have a church father, this is your church father right here. Now, the Bible tells us very clearly in the book of Matthew to call no man on earth our father. For we have one father who is in heaven. Kind of puts the whole Catholicism thing in the trash basket, doesn't it? But that's another study. So this is exactly what Paul is talking about here in Romans 8:17. He says very clearly, he says, the Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God, and if children, then heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with him in order that we may also be glorified with him. Okay, let's continue. Romans 8:18, he says, for I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing to the glory that is to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be free from its bondage to corruption and obtain the freedom of glory of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation has been groaning together in the pains of childbirth until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit groan inwardly, as we wait eagerly for adoptions as sons, the redemption of our bodies. Now, I just want us to see this, and I want to stop right here, and I want us to read this very carefully. How many times have you heard people saying, I'm saved, I'm saved, I'm saved, I believe, I believe, I believe, not even knowing what believing even means, not even knowing the biblical definition of faith. And you must have faith. If you don't have faith in the obedience of faith that Paul talks about in the first chapter of Romans, then we do not have what we need to be able to follow the laws of God Yahweh properly. And this is very important. And we are not saved right now, right now, right now. We have the hope of salvation right now. We don't actually receive the gift or our crown of salvation until after the redemption of our bodies. And what does Paul say here? He says, and not only the creation, but we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. So again, we don't receive the crown, we don't receive the gift until the redemption of our bodies, until resurrection day. Hopefully, we are in the first resurrection and not the second. So he continues on, and he says in Romans 8:24, he says, "For in this hope," notice this, "in this hope," he says, "we are saved," because we have this hope of the salvation. Once again, we can fall out of grace. There is no such thing as once saved, always saved. At any point in time, we can fall out. And we'll see this as we come up on Romans chapter 11, when Paul really gets into explaining this more in detail. So he says, "For in this hope," let me turn that down, get that out of the way, that little beeping sound. I apologize for that. He says, "For in this hope we were saved. Now, hope that is seen is not hope. For who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience." Again, my friends, no one is saved right now, right now, right now. We must walk in the ways of Yahweh God the Father. We are saved by the grace of God through faith. But we must have true faith, which means having the Holy Spirit of God, having the laws of God written in our hearts and in our minds, and have the obedience of faith to follow the laws, commandments, precepts of God, Yahweh God the Father. And then we have the hope. We hope for what we do not see. We have patience to wait and to know and to understand that salvation is indeed promised to us who endure to the end. Matthew, the 24th chapter of Matthew, our Messiah tells us, "He who endures to the end will be saved." So we need to understand these things. We need to know that the devil is like a lion. He is roaming around trying to steal our salvation, and we could lose this salvation if we are not careful. So it is imperative that we know these things. If you're running around thinking that you're once saved, always saved, and you can just return like a dog back to your vomit, and you're going to be okay, and everything's going to be wonderful and peachy keen, you need to know and understand that you have been fed a pack of lies. That is a lie. We cannot return to our sin like a dog to its vomit. And we know that by reading very clearly Hebrews 10:26, and it tells us that very clearly. Okay, let's continue on now. Romans 8:26, he says, "Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. For we do not know what to pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words." Again, there we need the Holy Spirit of God to be dwelling within us. "He who says he knows him, but does not keep his commandments is a liar, and the truth is not in him. For this is the love of God." Biblical definition of the love of God. It says, "For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome." And we can find that in 1 John 5:3. Okay? So that is the love of God, that we keep his commandments. That is the biblical definition of the love of God, according to the word of God, not according to some man standing behind a pulpit. Okay. He says, "Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know what to pray as we ought, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And he who searches hearts knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers." Now, I want us to read this again. "For those who he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son." Did Yahweh God the Father, did Yahweh Yeshua follow the commandments of God? Yes, he did. Did he attend the feast days? Yes, he did. Did he keep the seventh-day Sabbath? Yes, he did. Did he rest on the seventh-day Sabbath? And then after honoring the Sabbath, then did he arise from his grave? Yes, he did. Keeping the seventh-day Sabbath, not changing it, he arose on first fruits. That means after the seventh-day Sabbath. He did not raise on the Sabbath. He honored the Sabbath. And we can know and understand these things if we will just read the Bible. So, once again, my friends, we are to be conformed to the image of his Son. If he fulfilled the law, we should strive to fulfill the law also. And if we have the Holy Spirit of God and we are living in the Spirit, not living in the flesh, we will have the obedience of faith that Paul tells us about in the very first chapter of Romans chapter 1. Okay, let's continue. And those whom he predestined, he called, and those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he glorified. Now, what's he talking about predestined? We get all kinds of people that are all wondering, what does that mean, predestined, predestined, predestined? He's talking about the northern kingdom, the lost sheep of Israel, the original by blood Israelites that he divorced. Yahweh God the Father divorced the northern kingdom and sent them, dispersed them into the four corners of the earth, even though they were predestined to be his chosen people. This is what he's talking about. Why did Yeshua come back for the lost sheep of Israel? He says, I came back for the lost sheep of Israel. Why did he do that? Because he had to take the two sticks of Ezekiel, the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom, and reconnect the two kingdoms together to bind the Israelite people together. The olive tree now becomes one tree, and everyone who believes is now grafted into that olive tree. And we will see that in Romans 11. I know we talk a lot about Romans 11 today. You can jump ahead if you choose to, but we will cover that coming up. Again, Romans 11, and I encourage you to do so. Read Romans 11 if you are unsure of who you are as a Christian. You need to know and you need to understand these things, and also Galatians 3:27 as well. Read them both and know who you are as a Christian. If you do not know these things, please. And we also have a video teaching in our five-part series, God's Laws Still Stand. I believe it is the second part, God's Laws Still Stand, Part 2, The Identity of a True Christian. You can go there and check that out. Look at that video, and that will give you more insight as to what we will be looking at here in Romans 11 very shortly. Okay, so, very good. What shall we say then to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he also with him graciously give us all things? He says, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? He says, who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is it to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died. More than that, who was raised? Who is it that is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us? Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword, or the loss of a job, or poverty, or have any of these things? How can any of these things separate us from the love of Christ? Who, what can separate us? Absolutely nothing. And I want us to continue on. These are just great scriptures to know and to understand. He says, as it is written, for your sake we are being killed all day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ the Messiah. This is where we need to return as the church of God, as the body of Christ, as the reunited olive tree. We need to know and understand what Paul is talking about here. There is nothing that can separate us from his love if we have faith and if we believe on him, truly believe, not just say we believe. And this, again, is where people really get lost. And again, we have a Bible study teaching on what is faith. If you would like to visit us at holyimpactministries.com, you can go to our HIM video studies page, and you will find that video on what is faith there, and you can take a look at that and know and understand what is faith. Is faith just saying, okay, I have faith, I just something I say? Or does faith have obedience, as Paul says it does in the very first chapter of the book of Romans? Yes, it does. So we can know and we can understand. Paul says, do we nullify the law by this faith? He says, absolutely not. On the contrary, we uphold the law. And very clearly throughout this scripture, we can know and we can understand that Paul is not doing away with the laws of God. And he says very clearly, he says, for the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus, not from the law, but from the law, not from the laws of God, but from the law of sin and death. Now, if he wanted to say that the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Jesus Christ from the law of God, he would have said so right here. It's not what he says. He says from the law of sin and death, from the penalty of the law. And this, right here in Romans 8:2, when someone gets confused and doesn't know, and they say, well, what did he come to die for then? You can just point them to Romans 8:2, read it for yourself. He came to die to do away with the law of sin and death, the curse of the law. Okay? That does not mean that the law of God is done away with. By no means we uphold the law, just as Paul says, Romans 3:31. I hope and I pray that this has been a blessing to you. We will move into the 9th chapter next week, Wednesday at 8 o'clock. I'd like to thank you so very much for being with us here at Holy Impact Ministries Bible Study Night. Each Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we have a Bible study, and we welcome everyone to that Bible study. This video is also free to everyone to download, to use as you please. We ask that you please don't sell the video. All of our videos at holyimpactministries.com are free to download, burn to a CD, use them at your Bible study, show them, talk about them, tear them apart, build your own Bible study. It is important for us not to only learn these things, but to be able ourselves to go out into the world and teach these things. Each one of us should be a pastor. Men, are you not pasturing your wives? Wives, are you not pasturing your children? Children, are you not pasturing your friends? All of us need to pasture someone. We should all be pasturing someone. You know, the Bible tells us very clearly, and we are commanded in the book of Matthew by our Messiah, and he says, don't call anyone rabbi. He says, for you are all brothers, and you have one teacher. He says, call no man on earth your father, for you have one father who is in heaven. He says, and call no man your instructor, for you have one instructor, the Christ. Now, we know and we understand, if we read the Bible, if we read the book of Ephesians, that God gave pastors and teachers and people to build up the body of Christ so that we could worship him properly in spirit and in truth. So we know that that we have pastors still, we have teachers still, but the day will come, and if we read Jeremiah 31:31, the day will come in the future during the millennial kingdom where there won't be any pastors. We won't have to say, who do you know, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ? Because we will all know him. And that day is coming. And I, for one, cannot wait. Through all of the things that we are seeing in 2016, we know that in the end, all of these things that we have to go through, all of these painful things, it says very clearly at the end, he will wipe the tear away from everyone's eyes. There will be no more sickness, no more death, no more pain, no more depression, none of those things, no more addiction, none of it. It will all be taken away. And we won't have to have any more pastors, preachers, teachers, bishops, and those types of things. So what a grand thing that we have to look forward to. What we don't even know the treasures that we have been promised. We have no idea, but we do know that we need to be in that coming kingdom, and we need to expand that coming kingdom. And the only way we can do that is to be able to learn these things, to keep Paul in the right context, to understand that he was not preaching against the laws of God. And he never preached against circumcision. We've already been through that. In fact, we have videos at our website concerning the fact that he did not preach against circumcision. You can check those out, holyimpactministries.com. Before I let you go, I just want to say this. A lot of you are now signing up for the newsletter at holyimpactministries.com. Please do that, because this is our way of staying in contact with you. So if you enjoy Holy Impact Ministries, if you enjoy these Bible studies, if you're learning anything, if you'd like to know more, please subscribe to our newsletter at holyimpactministries.com, and we'll stay in touch with you to let you know what we're going to be doing next, and what's coming up, and what is happening in the ministry. Once again, we just want to thank all of you who are supporting us here at holyimpactministries.com. God bless you, and thank you so very much for your participation in expanding the coming kingdom. With all of that being said, I just want to say that my prayer is that the grace and the peace of God would be with you and your family until we meet again, and the protection of God's hand would be upon you. I'm Pastor Scott Blaine with HolyImpactMinistries.com. Thank you again. God bless, and shalom.